We have a great topic tonight. We're going to talk about Abraham Zacuto, also known as Zacut or Zechut, a fascinating individual, an early astronomer, and in many ways the last great Iberian Jewish scientist. And so much of our talk is going to talk about science in this period, the very unique role that Jews played in transmitting science to the Christian world in particular, and we'll have some reflections on what the decline of Judaism in the Iberian Peninsula really means. Today is the first of three lectures that's going to look at the expulsion. We're just going to touch on it briefly today, sort of in passing for Zacuto's life. Next week and the week after, we're really going to focus on the details of the expulsion. And I have to say, the more I study it, the more it amazes me at its cruelty and the inexorable quality of the unfolding of the expulsion that really seemed to the Jews of the time to be a split in time, something that divided the pre-expulsion and the post-expulsion time, much like we view the Holocaust today. But I'm going to set that aside. Most of our discussion on that topic will be next week. Let me start with the joke, and I will tell you that I have tried to tell this joke four times in public now. I have yet to succeed. I happen to think it's a hilarious joke, but I just can't quite get the timing right for other people. So you will be my fifth guinea pigs. Here's how it goes. It's situated in the town of Chelm. Oh, well. I started telling you the joke this last week, and then we got off topic. I told you a different joke. This is a joke I meant to tell you 2 weeks ago. It's situated in the town of Chelm. You'll recall that's like in Eastern Europe. It's sort of like the fictitious place of foolish Jews. And you'll remember the joke about the bread, and he drops the bread. That's how it goes. So this joke is about a horse thief. So there's this horse thief in Chelm, and he's one night he's going into this Jewish man's barn, and he finds a horse there, kind of an old worn-out horse, but, you know, he's not going to complain. And so he takes the horse, and he's leading it outside of the barn, and as the horse is going out, the horse kicks, and he knocks over some rakes and things like that, makes a big ruckus. And so the Jew living in the next door house, he opens up his door. He says, "What's going on? What's going on in there?" The thief manages to rush into the woods with the horse, but the Jew doesn't give up. He starts looking around. He starts looking around, going out to the glade of trees there. And he says, "What's going on? Who's out there?" And so finally, the thief ties the horse to a tree, and he says, "It's me." And the farmer says, "Who's me? Who's me?" And so the horse thief comes out, and the farmer says to him, "Chaim? My horse, Chaim? What happened to you?" He says, yes, I'm Chaim, your horse. I am Chaim, your horse. I was," and he on the spot, he thinks very quickly, and he says, it's a terrible thing, but in my previous life, I was not very honest, and I stole from people, and so as a punishment, I was reincarnated as a horse, and I was sent to work for honest Jews like you and to pay off my debt, and as of today, my debt has been completely, made equal, and now I've been transformed into a human being again." And the farmer, credulous Chelmite that he is so amazed with this story. He says, "This is fantastic. I have to bring you inside. Meet the Rebbetzin. Come on in." He sits them down at the table. They feed him and they clothe him. They ask him what it was like being a horse. He makes up a whole story, things like this. And at the end of the night, he says, "Listen, so you'll sleep over?" And he says, "No, I really do have to go. I can't stay. I have many places I need to go and many amends that I need to make." So they say goodbye to him. He goes out into the forest, and he unties the horse from a tree and takes him off. A couple days later, the farmer decides that that he's got to buy a new horse, so he goes into town to replace the horse. Goes into the horse market, and he's looking at one horse, another horse, then all of a sudden he sees one horse that looks suspiciously familiar. Goes up to him, he sees it's the same coloration, about the same posture, same height, checks its teeth, even checks the ear where there's a little nick from an earlier injury, and he looks the horse in the eye and he says, "Chaim, it's only been a few days. What did you do wrong this time?" Okay. Not that funny, right? But okay, I tried. I'll keep practicing until I get that joke right. Thank you for laughing. I appreciate your very polite audience. Okay, thank you to Mr. Sklar for our lecture for tonight. He's a live participant in the lectures, and it's great to have him here. He votes to continue these lectures, and I think we agree. One small bit of good and welfare. I'm kind of proud. This is my YouTube page, and this is a screenshot I took this morning. We just hit 10,000 subscribers, which is kind of a nice number. I'm hoping YouTube will send me a little letter or put a little star on my name or something, but I don't know. There's actually 10,000 is my statistics indicate that about 75% of the people who watch these lectures have not subscribed. They just, you know, lurk on the outside, and that's great. So this number is actually quite a bit bigger, which is very exciting. And of course, the videos are also watched on Facebook and Twitter and places like that too. Okay, another really important thing, this is a good and welfare announcement. Next Tuesday, a week from tomorrow, we're going to have a very special event right here in this room. We're going to have a live poetry reading by an exceptional individual, our very own Professor Yoshua November. He teaches composition here at the college, and he is an award-winning poet. We have spent a lot of time talking about poetry in the Andalusian period. We should actually hear a real poet speak. He has published two books. He'll be reading from his newest book. He has published in the New York Times, the Chicago Tribune, many literary publications. And he is a finalist for the National Jewish Book Awards as well. We have a rare privilege to have him on our campus. And I think it's going to be a fantastic treat for all of us to hear him Tuesday night, not tomorrow, but next week, 7:30 to 8:30. He'll be reading his poetry. We will have refreshments. And he is, by the way, perhaps the number one most popular professor on campus. So I think we will have a lot of students here as well. It's going to be a really special evening. I hope you'll be able to come. I know it's a Tuesday, but if you can make it on Tuesday night next week, it will be fantastic. Okay, so jumping ahead to where we left off. Okay, let's go straight to the material then. Abraham Zacuto. So the name Zacuto, it's a Latinization of the Hebrew term zechut, which means merit, and it's variously transliterated. Zacuto is perhaps the most common of them. His years, as you can see, straddle the horrific expulsion of 1492 and the subsequent Portuguese expulsion of 1497, which is somewhat more complex, but in many ways even more cruel than the Spanish expulsion, and that we will push off a little bit until next week. His major activity was first as an astronomer, and he did some very important work with the astrolabe and with the Alphonsine tables, which helped much world navigators make their way around the globe, and was especially important to the Portuguese crown. He was a direct advisor to Vasco da Gama, who was one of the great explorers of the century. In fact, in many ways, the Portuguese made their name as the greatest of the explorers of the era, largely because of men like Abraham Zacuto, who supported them with their scientific research. Towards the end of his life, however, he changed gears in a very dramatic fashion. And he ceased working almost completely on scientific matters and turned his mind to things Jewish. And he wrote a very important historical account of the world and of the Iberian period as well in his Sefer Yuchasin. So he kind of changed and became much more of a Jewishly motivated. In this sense, he's very much like the greatest of the Iberian masters that we've looked at, people like Maimonides and Yehuda Halevi, Shmuel HaNagid, who are able to excel in their secular activities and in their Jewish activities simultaneously. After perhaps the last we will study in 2 weeks is Don Isaac Abravanel. That's probably the last of the great Iberian Jews who were able to do these kinds of things, being both excellent in a non-Jewish pursuit as well as Jewish pursuit simultaneously. And in many ways, we haven't had anyone like that in 500 years. So it's a very, very unique period. Perhaps we'll have some time to contemplate at the end of this course, or the end of this semester, why is it, what were the conditions that made it so possible in the Iberian Peninsula and not elsewhere? This is his grandson, by the way. Perhaps it looks like the grandfather, we don't know, but his grandson was also quite a famous scientist, and as a result, we have his likeness here. His activity was primarily in astronomy and astrology. And if you'll recall what we spoke about in a lecture about Ibn Ezra, these two terms were kind of interchangeable at the time. Astronomy, of course, the study of the various planetary bodies and the understanding of their various orbits and paths and so on. And astrology, a little bit more of the on the woo-woo side of science, where you look at the impact of those planetary bodies on human life, fading off into horoscopes and things like that. We did see with Ibn Ezra also a little bit earlier than this, but also very much kind of straddling the scientific and the, maybe we could say, superstitious elements of approaching the stars, although there is a very hoary tradition of respecting the influence of planetary bodies on human affairs throughout the Talmud and later. Ibn Ezra perhaps gave us the best sense of how you could rationally, bring these two beliefs together in a consistent system. But this, we'll also see the same thing happening with Abraham Zacuto. At this time, in one of the several articles I wrote about science at the time, there was one particular noble person, I forget his name, but he had the cataract removed from his right eye, and it was done successfully by a Jewish doctor. And so he wrote to the Jewish doctor saying, that worked out fantastically well. I'd like to have the left cataract removed as well, please. I apologize. I should have remembered all the names, but I didn't think I would actually end up talking about it. But it came to my mind. Anyways, he said, let's do the left eye as well. And the Jewish doctor said, not so fast. The reason why the operation on your right eye went so well is because all of the stars were perfectly aligned for an operation that day. I do not calculate that the next auspicious day for the left eye operation will occur for another 12 years. I happen to have an opening, though. So so he actually suggested he not have the operation because the stars are not so aligned. But you see in this example, sort of like the uneasy coexistence of a pre-modern sensibility with much more advanced scientific techniques happening simultaneously. He studied at the University of Salamanca. He was born in 1452 in that region, and he actually taught astronomy there as well, working in their famed library. This is actually quite likely the actual room that he stood in as he spoke about astronomy and astrology to his students there. This is, again, one of those very special periods of time in which, in the pursuit of knowledge, the pure pursuit of knowledge, there was no or little distinction paid to the religious background of the person who was sharing that knowledge with students. It is a very bright but very fleeting moment in world history. We see so few elements of this throughout the last few centuries, but this is one of those brief periods when, because of his demonstrated knowledge, he was able to actually rise and teach Christians in a secular environment like the college. In fact, he enjoyed the patronage of the church, largely because of a work he wrote called Hachibor HaGadol, the Great Collection, or the Great Book, which is essentially a Hebrew compilation of astronomical teachings. He viewed himself as a descendant, an intellectual descendant of Maimonides, and that he was improving on Maimonidean theorems for how the astronomy could be calculated and the planetary bodies could be tracked. Maimonides definitely did take a big step forward from the Talmud in terms of understanding things such as the appearance of the moon, the renewal of the moon, the calculation of the seasons. And this is, by the way, something which is essential to Judaism. It's one of those ironic things that one of the first Jewish publications that are ever put out, especially when a community moves to a new region, one of the first things they put out is this listing of all the Chinese restaurants, and then immediately after that, immediately after that, they put out a calendar. Calendars are crucial because we are bound to the calculation of the Passover holiday, Yom Kippur, all kinds of things like this. So this is a long pursuit of Jews, is understanding exactly how to determine the calendrical cycle of the year for ritual purposes. Let us recall, if you'll permit me just a slight kind of like footnote on this, the Jewish calendar is extremely complicated. The Christians follow basically a solar calendar, which is a little complicated because it doesn't work out to exactly 365 days a year. Hence, you have to have a leap year. There are actually more than one calendrical variations. Europe moved away from the old Julian calendar to the Gregorian calendar, which was losing a day every 10 years, I think it was, or every century. I think it was every century. Russia, by the way, only got on board with a Gregorian calendar in the 20th century. Yeah, so they actually have an 11-day gap where nothing happened in Russian history because they had to catch up. The Muslims follow a lunar calendar, which goes according to the 12 lunar months, but that means it's only 359 days a year. And so that means that the seasons are constantly shifting. You know, if you go over a 10-year period, you'll see that the holidays that were in the fall one year will be in the summer another year, and so on. The Jewish calendar basically follows a lunar pattern, just like the Muslims later adopted, but there are certain key pegs in time that are mandated by scripture. The holiday of Passover is called Chag HaAviv, the holiday of spring. So you cannot have Passover occur anytime except the spring. And in order to make that happen, we have a complicated 19-year cycle of leap months, that an entire month is added to make sure the Passover always falls out in the springtime. Hence, our fascination with the calendar goes back a long, long time, and we actually excelled in these kind of astronomical calculations. The Bishop of Salamanca was so taken with Abraham Zacuto's works that he asked them to be translated. They were actually rendered into Castilian, which was like one of the local languages, Romance languages of the period, and also into Latin. And the bishop ordered that all of these Jewish writings should be stored permanently in the library of the cathedral. Rather impressive. The language stuff is also very interesting because this is a period of great linguistic flexibility and transition when the Jews had a tremendous advantage because they were historically quite I was going to say the word polyglottish, but that doesn't sound very nice, does it? They were multilingual. Polyglottish sounds terrible. It sounds like something that's a condition. You have to go see a doctor. Oh my gosh, I'm feeling so polyglottish today. Okay, let us look to this subject of what exactly is science and take a little bit of a broader perspective on Sephardim and science. Here's one of the most interesting things that he did, by the way. He also engineered a massive technological revolution by taking the astrolabes, which up until this point were made out of wood, and he designed them out of copper, which not only made them far more durable, we even actually have astrolabes from the 15th century as a result of his innovations, but they are also much more accurate because wood, of course, is subject to the vagaries of moisture and time and things like that. Just to remind you what the astrolabe was for, this is a remarkably important device that was incredibly popular in the 15th century. Everybody was writing about it, including Ibn Ezra, who wrote a treatise on how to use these devices and so on. It's basically an instrument that can measure distances over long distances. Like if you what you do is you it has like moving arms, and you stick your eye on one spot and you line up the arms. Like let's say you want to measure the height of a tall building or a mountain far away, you line up one arm with the top of that building the way it looks into your naked eye, and you line up a horizontal beam with the bottom of that mountain. And then when you've got it, it moves. When you've got it lined up properly, you can then simply take the measurement, place it on a scale, and calculate how tall that building is and how far away it is. You can do the same thing with planetary bodies. So you can measure how big the moon is, how far the moon is from other planets, all kinds of amazing things that were, you know, impossible without this amazing little device. And it allowed for, finally, easy navigation of the seas without, you know, local landmarks, or to move away from shore for any distance, because you could keep your bearings with the stars. So making it into copper, later into bronze, was exceptionally important in terms of the durability of this device. And he was associated very closely with it, as were many Jews of the time. But what exactly is science? We've already talked about the way that astronomy and astrology kind of melded together. There's basically, at this time, we're still working with the medieval trivium and quadrivium, the definition of the classic ideas of what is the, you know, the essence of scientific knowledge. The trivium, or three items, were grammar, rhetoric, and dialectics. These are kind of like the basic humanities that you just had to know if you were going to be an educated person. It's ironic that of the three, we basically only study a little bit of the first one, and that primarily at the primary and secondary levels. Like, I mean, how many people really know how to use a comma well? Not too many of our freshmen, I'll tell you that. We really work them hard on the commas. And apostrophes, forget about it. Rhetoric, we only have one course in rhetoric. It is a required course, thank God. It's a, you know, principles of public speaking. But this is a subject that people used to spend years and years studying, how to speak effectively, how to argue effectively, and it's largely gone the wayside. And dialectics, which is basically logic, you know, you only study this if you're going to go into math, or if you're going to go into philosophy, things like that, maybe into law. So we've really, the trivium has been watered down significantly. We also have, however, the quadrivium, which are four other cool things people should learn. Arithmetic, of course, mathematics. Music, which we have also basically lost. It's very rare for people to actually study music at a higher level. Third is geometry, which is related, of course, to arithmetic, but much more in the physical sciences. And then finally, astrology / astronomy, because these two things were not clearly defined from each other. You'll note that this is the period of time, I'm talking about 13th, 14th century, the Renaissance, when the idea of wisdom being too big for any one person to handle is just beginning to take hold. You still have what you call the Renaissance man, people like Da Vinci, Michelangelo, who are doing it all. But the idea that, you know what, maybe we should break this out, maybe we should specialize, because you're just not going to be able to find people who can manage all these things. To be a doctor, a magister, at this time, was someone who really could handle all world knowledge, basically. You could grasp it all. You have to divide into these sections, but this is going to be fading, and shortly thereafter, we'll have our faculties of arts and science that will specialize in various things. One of the most important roles that Jews played was in bringing, as we saw in an earlier lecture when we talked about literature, bringing Greek wisdom through its Arabic translation into the Christian environment. It's Arabic into Latin, Greek into Arabic into Latin. And many of the figures who played a role in this transmission of Greek wisdom through Arabic transmission into the Christian environment were converts, such as this individual, Petrus Alphonsus, who was also known as Moshe HaSfaradi, Moses the Sephardi, who was a Spanish Jew who moved to Europe, to Christian Europe, and converted to Christianity, and then made a career, essentially, out of translating what he remembered from when he grew up in Andalus, what he remembered of Arabic science, for Christian readers. You can see in this piece of art here, he's having a debate with Moses himself. Moses, of course, is depicted as Jewish. This is a hat which the Jews were required to wear after the Fourth Lateran Council of 1215. It's called the Judenhut, the Jewish hat. You can see it's related to the witch's hat and to the dunce cap, things like that, which, you know, because it's obviously a silly hat, makes people look absurd, that kind of thing. Petrus, on the other hand, although he's wearing a turban, which is meant to look kind of like Middle Eastern, sort of exotic, he still has a much more dignified bearing even than Moses. Moses here, these hand gestures, by the way, are really complicated in medieval art. They actually tell a whole story based on how the hands are depicted. Moses is trying to explain a complicated subject, and Petrus is making it very simple with a declarative finger in the air. This is like an aggressive gesture in medieval art. I'm telling you, buddy. It's like a strong kind of pointing gesture. In many homes, even to this day, of course, pointing is considered rude. My wife doesn't like when the kids point like that, too. Anyways, this is like Petrus Alphonsus is like one of these many, many Jews who are not especially learned. He was not like the brightest kid in yeshiva, but he knew a lot because, you know, the general level of literacy of Jews was quite high in multiple languages. He had a smattering of logic, a smattering of the sciences, and he made his way into Christian Europe, where people are still living on, you know, with mud floors and sleeping with their animals in their barns to keep warm and things like that. And he knew so much that he was immediately a celebrity. When you had real people like Ibn Ezra come into the north and offer the same kind of information on a much more sophisticated level, then people like Petrus Alphonsi were out of a job. But there is nevertheless always a market for Jews who sort of jump over the wall and sell the secrets to the larger population. He was a little bit of a strange bird. Here is one of his drawings in which he attempted to unify the four-letter name of God, the Tetragrammaton, shown here in this representation, with the Christian Trinity, and he had like this whole kind of like pseudo-theology built around these ideas. But that's just kind of a cool sort of picture. Anyways, Petrus Alphonsus proposed a seven-part division of science that looks like this. Dialectics, arithmetic, geometry, physics. Physics would basically be medicine. Music, astronomy, and then the seventh subject is unfortunately lost. Some have argued that he believed the seventh science was necromancy, meaning black magic, you know, using the dead to achieve metaphysical aims or, you know, theurgic aims, philosophy or perhaps grammar. All this to say that science at this time is producing some tremendous technological achievements. The astrolabe is one of those amazing things that suddenly allows people to, you know, like kind of iPhone their way out of the dial-up zone of history, but they're not exactly sure how to catalog it and how to manage it in a sophisticated way. That will come over the great scientific explosions that will occur in Europe. Now, as I've mentioned, the role that many of these Jewish scholars played, and Abraham Zacuto was prominent among them, was in bringing the wisdom that was originally belonging to the Greeks through Arabic and then Hebrew and into the Latin translation. You'll recall, since we're speaking in a Western environment here, we even have this term, the Middle Ages, and the reason why we use this kind of strange term, what is it the middle of? It is the middle of the Golden Age that is represented by the Periclean period, the 500 years before the Common Era in Greece, when you have Socrates and Aristotle and Pythagoras and all these brilliant Greek thinkers. And then you have this, it does pretty well under the Romans. And then when Rome is sacked in the 5th century, it goes downhill really fast. And all of Europe is plunged into the Dark Ages. Then you have the Renaissance, 1,000 years later, where it begins to climb out of the Dark Ages. So that's very true for Christian Europe, where you have that kind of big gap in the middle, a big valley, and the Middle Ages is like between those two peaks. For the Muslim culture, however, you can't really say they have a Middle Ages, right? Islam starts in the 7th century. They spread tremendously fast over North Africa, the Middle East, into Spain. They have tremendous successes in culture, in literature, in sciences, and they eventually take the Greek wisdom and they do tremendous things with it. And so they've got kind of like an uphill climb. And then when they get to the 15th century and the 16th century, that's when they start their decline. They don't catch up with the Industrial Revolution that explodes in Christian Europe. But they don't have a Middle Ages. And also, when you look at Jewish history, I mean, how do you put a Middle Ages into Jewish history? When the Christians were in the middle of theirs, you know, we had Rashi and we had Tosfos and we had all these tremendous thinkers, Maimonides. How can you call that a middle of anything? That's a peak in many ways for us. But nevertheless, the Christians were catching up when the Jews were bringing this wisdom to them in the Latin tongue. How was this done? Primarily through duo translations, in which you would typically have two figures, a Jew and a Christian, who would transmit this knowledge into a Latin text for Latin reading public. The Jew would know Arabic, sometimes Greek, and would know a Romance language that would be a vernacular, and the Christian would know the vernacular and Latin. You also had some individuals who would know all three, but the majority of these translations were done by Jews in partnership with Christians. And they would do this orally, by the way. So basically, the Jew would be holding an Arabic text, and he would translate it into Catalan or Castilian or something like that, which was not in itself considered a suitable vehicle for scholarly transmission. It would be like translating it into Yiddish, and people would say, you know, Yiddish, what kind of a language is that? We're not going to be able to publish anything in Yiddish. Of course, that turned out not to be true either, but it was considered a joual. It was considered like a koine, a street language, a jargon. And so the Jew would translate it into the local language, the Christian would understand it, and then would render it into Latin for a reading public. And there's a tremendous amount of this going on. All kinds of books were being published with these duo translations. The Jew, by the way, rarely got credit for it. Usually the translation was only written in the name of the Christian translator, but in the introductory essays, they would often at least thank the Jew who was involved in transferring it over into the Castilian. This changed to a certain degree in the 13th century with Alfonso X of Castile, who said, okay, enough of this. Why don't we just use the vernacular? And he ordered the production of many works in Castilian, which began the explosion of vernacular languages throughout Europe, really, including a few hundred years later, even Yiddish becomes a written language. But just to point out how ironic that is, my grandmother, Alea Shalom, who was born probably around 1910, we're not exactly sure because, you know, the records, but she does remember when she was a little child, she fell off a train when they were fleeing the Germans in World War I. So we were guessing she was about 4 years old when she fell off the train, and that's how we get the year 1910 for her. At any rate, she, in English, didn't have a word for the Yiddish language. She would speak of it as Jewish. I'm speaking Jewish, meaning that's how she referred to it, because it wasn't considered, in her mind, it wasn't considered a real language, even though she had newspapers and she had Shalom Aleichem and she had many other things. It was just not considered real. Anyways, I'm getting off topic. Alfonso X was especially important for creating what was called the Alfonsine tables. I don't exactly understand what these things mean, but they're a whole series of astronomical tables that somehow allow scientists to figure out exactly the movements of the planets and the stars by cataloging them through this tables. Jews were heavily involved in creating the Alfonsine tables, and Abraham Zacuto in particular was responsible for perfecting them in the 15th century. Okay, what happens with Zacuto? As I mentioned, we're just going to skip over the expulsion for now because it's way too complicated, and we'll dive into it with a very sad story next week when we look at Abraham Senor, one of the senior figures of the Jewish community in Spain, who ultimately decides to convert to Christianity and remain. Zacuto is one of these illustrious figures who, despite his great scientific and philosophical achievement, is not allowed to remain in Spain. So he flees, like many Jews do, to neighboring Portugal, and he continues his excellence in his field in that part of the peninsula. He's appointed to be the royal astronomer to King João II. I really like pronouncing that name, João. And it's sometimes in certain texts it's rendered as John, just to make it easy. But it's João. I don't know how to say it, but I like the idea of João. Like, can you imagine when he was born and the parents said, João, it's a boy. You know. But anyways, there he is, the João. He was appointed royal astronomer and was at the top of his game with tremendous activity, especially after he went over the Alfonsine tables, which at this point were 200 years old, and he apparently corrected all of the errors, which made it really possible for navigation to take place on a sophisticated level. It's also interesting to note that, you know, what happened in Portugal, we'll explore this more in the next two lectures, but you know, the Jews had a pretty good situation in Portugal. They were kicked out of Spain. They're in Portugal, but in order to effect a dynastic marriage later, one of the conditions was the Jews have to be removed from Portugal as well. So 5 years later, largely to effect a political dynastic union, the Jews were demanded to leave as well, unless they were to convert to Christianity. He advised at this time Vasco da Gama, and in fact predicted his many successes with a tremendous level of confidence, saying, look, you're working with really good instruments. You've got my copper astrolabe. You've got my perfected Alfonsine tables. You cannot go wrong. And in fact, Vasco da Gama did tremendously well. I rounded the Cape of Good Hope and visited India, and really, in many ways, initiated a tremendous amount of transatlantic ocean voyages as well by using these kinds of things that Zacuto had pioneered. Okay, but as I mentioned, even though Zacuto had an illustrious career as an astronomer and as a scientist, he was ultimately forced to leave Portugal, and at that point he sort of re-examined his bearings, if we can extend this astronomical metaphor, and he tacked on a totally different course. He fled with the masses of Portuguese Jews, many of whom were originally Spanish Jews who had moved to Portugal after 1492. He was captured twice, very difficult, ransomed being held by pirates. He eventually settled in Tunis. Later he made his way actually to Israel, and then he died in Damascus. And at this point, he just changed everything. He said, you know what? I'm no longer gonna write about astronomy. He did complete one small book, but it was not one of his, it was just kind of like a memoir sort of work. And he wrote this book called Sefer Yuchasin, which is a fascinating title. Yuchasin means lineage, from Yichus, that's the term we use in Hebrew as well. And it basically traces the lineage of the Jewish people. And he wrote in Hebrew, although he wrote many of his other works in Hebrew as well, he chose to specifically devote Hebrew to this particular book. It seems that he sort of had a change of heart and said that I've given so much to the world in terms of science, and look how myself and my people have been treated. Let me focus my energies now on doing something specifically for my people. And he looked inward, reflected inward on the nature of the precariousness of Jewish existence as a minority in these states. And he wrote essentially a history of Jewish persecution. describing how Jews were moving from one location to another, chased from one inhospitable climate to another, despite their contributions to large society. This is one of the early works in what the professor Salo Baron of Columbia University called the lachrymose model of Jewish history, in which lachrymose means tear-filled, in that we have this view of Jewish history as, you know, we're constantly harangued and chased from one place to another, and at the same time we're doing so much more for the societies around us, and it's a very martyr-like kind of image. Which reminds me of a joke. Please forgive me if I tell you this one more joke. I know we're near the end of the lecture, but I have to tell you this is a funny joke. So my jokes are not by definition funny. But the joke goes like this. This is I actually heard this when I was doing my own doctoral research in the former Soviet Union. And if you'll recall what it was like back then, so much shortages of consumer goods that lines would form everywhere, the drop of a hat. You know, if they heard that a particular store was opening, people would stand in line and they would buy anything. They had Czechoslovakian shoes, only size 7. You would buy as many as you could, and then later you would barter them, you know, in the various open air markets for different things. So anyways, there's this lineup, a cherha, outside a grocery store, and because they heard there's cucumbers going to be on sale. And everyone's standing there in line, and there are all these different nationalities, you know, Russians and Latvians and Lithuanians and Uzbeks and Jews and all kinds of people. So they're standing in line, and the door opens or the window opens, and the manager leans out and he says, "We've just learned that one of the trucks of cucumbers, it has broken down. It will not arrive. Therefore, all Jews, please leave the line." So what can they do? You know, they pack up, they leave the line. He closes the window. A little later, he opens up the window. He says, "We've just learned that one of the trucks has been stolen by the mafia, and we're going to have less cucumbers than we expected. So therefore, all Central Asians, please leave the line. Uzbeks, Tatars, Kazakhs, all leave the line." So, you know, they have to leave. This goes on. Lithuanians leave, Latvians, Poles, everyone's leaving, until finally there's only pure Soviet citizens standing in line. And the guy opens up the door and he says, "We've just learned the last truck has caught fire, and there were no trucks arriving today, no cucumbers at all. Everyone, please go home." So Ivan turns to Petro and says, "You see, the Jews get all the breaks." Okay. All right. So in many ways, the Sefer Yochasan, which is, we're talking now about a 16th century history, follows a model that we repeated over and over again by many historians. It's not the first of this series. You could even say that some of the biblical books follow within this kind of metaphor of the lachrymose model, where the Jews get all the breaks, said with a certain amount of black humor. But nevertheless, it is a testament to the work of his maturity, the work of his old age, as he reflects on the meaning of Jewish existence in the diaspora. So, in terms of his legacy, we get a sense of the importance of people like Zacuto for understanding the Iberian reality. They were somehow, first under Muslims and then under Christians like Zacuto, somehow able to leverage their superior education, their literacy, their openness to scientific ideas, to achieve phenomenal success within their societies. With a few exceptions, like Maimonides, who were forced to leave, many of them were able to climb to great heights. We've seen already Chasdai ibn Shaprut, the great diplomat, Shmuel HaNagid, who amazingly led a Muslim army for 16 years, an incredible thing. They should have a Jew doing this. And at the same time, writing an important Talmud commentary that's published with every tractate Brachot, even to this day. Yehuda Levi, the great secular poet and doctor, who at the same time is entertaining Arabic masses with his Hebrew poetry, with his Arabic poetry, excuse me, and Ibn Ezra and so on. Abraham Zacuto is the last, perhaps, of all of these figures who is somehow able to bring these things together in a unique form, contributing both to Jewish knowledge through his Sefer Yochasan, and at the same time contributing to world knowledge through the development of the copper astrolabe and the perfection of the Alphonsine tables. What are the factors that made it possible? It's very hard to identify any that were present at that time that are not present at other times. I would like to hazard, however, that some of the things might be a sort of openness to society in the Jewish world that was not necessarily present in other periods. An openness, an idea that Jews, you know, should not be closed off to any body of knowledge simply because they were Jewish. There was no idea that these scientific endeavors were somehow taboo because they were practiced primarily by Christians or by Muslims. Obviously, we don't have that many Jews excelling in Christian theology, or maybe we do, I haven't studied them. But that's probably, you know, the big part of the reason for their success is this lack of fear of the toxicity of outside society. At the same time, as we shall see beginning next week, it was indeed toxic because the ferocity of the first the Inquisition and then the expulsion was so unprecedented and so rapid that it's hard to imagine how this could have happened to any other society. The Jews were so well integrated into Spanish culture, both under the Muslims and later under the Christians, that one might think that their position was impregnable, but in reality, that was exactly what brought them down. As we shall see next week, it was the complicated relationship between the conversos and their attachment to the traditional Jewish community that ultimately made the expulsion inevitable to Ferdinand and Isabella, who were slaves to the ideology of the purity of the blood. That's something that we'll have to explore in much greater detail starting next week. I want to remind you that on Tuesday, not tomorrow, but next week, we will have that amazing Jewish poetry reading from Professor Yoshua November. I really hope to see you there. It'll be nice to sit with you in the audience and listen to someone else. And maybe he'll make some jokes and I can criticize them. But with that, I'd like to conclude the lecture for tonight. Thank you very much for coming, and I look forward to seeing you next week. Okay.